I was really not very well. There was this dream job that I was hoping to get, and obviously my self-esteem was pretty much non-existent. I just felt absolutely worthless, and I just didn't see a reason to go on.
I applied for a job as a healthcare assistant, and I was accepted for a job interview. The job centre suggested that I come along to SmartWorks.
SmartWorks provide interview clothing, interview preparation, just help give you that bit of confidence that everyone needs.
SmartWorks made me realise that the experience I had in the past with my grandfather was actually a unique selling point. It wasn't something that I should be ashamed of or feel that I missed out of my chance to do it before.
It sort of took a big weight from your shoulders immediately that you walked in the door. It just felt so good that somebody had taken an interest in me.
They greet you with a big, big smile. They shake your hand at the door. They just like woman to woman, it was really a natural experience. I didn't feel shy to get changed, to let them help unbutton me.
It was the first time in a long time that I'd ever felt good about myself. I felt like maybe I do deserve to have nice things, and maybe I'm not worthless.
As soon as you walk out of that dressing room and look at yourself in the mirror, you think, oh, you have to look twice. Is that really me? And it is. And then when you go for the interview and you get the job, it's like, wow, can't believe I did it.
Got the job. I got the job. And just looked like a normal member of the public going off to work, and I love it.
I've been offered an internship. I don't know how they've done it, but they found a way to help me get back to building up the person that I once was.
They made me feel like a person again. They made me feel like I counted, that I was part of society, not just another CV.
Hello everybody, I hope you can see me again. I haven't seen that film for a little while, and it's so wonderful to hear our clients talking such honest words about what it means to them to be able to come to SmartWorks. I think when one of our clients, Miriam, said there, I just felt like a normal member of society. It's a really wonderful and simple way to explain what it is that we do. Sorry, I'm just having a tiny bit of trouble with. It's just a really wonderful way to be able to explain what we do. So I just wanted to talk a little bit about what it is that we actually do. We give every woman who comes to see us, who will have a confirmed job interview, but typically will not have been successful at her interview, she will come to see us and we will give her a complete outfit of high quality interview clothing, one-to-one coaching, and then when she gets the job, a second appointment to build a capsule workwear wardrobe. So it sounds very simple, but actually what we're doing is allowing women just to connect with who she used to be or who she wants to be, and allow her to do and shine at this really crucial moment before a job interview. Often the women we see have been for so many job interviews and been told no so many times that it does really affect your self-esteem. And I think to come into a space, as you'll have heard one of our clients say there, which is safe and where she can be looked after and feel supported and not judged, not patronised, it's a very careful balance that we strike, is a really important part of what we do. And the other lovely thing about SmartWorks is that we have a very simple model. So all the women who dress our clients and all the women who coach our clients are volunteers who give us their time on a very regular basis and come and work with the women that we support. They'll find them the right outfit. And it's very much like a styling, personal shopping experience that we try to recreate. So a client will be asked what she enjoys wearing, and what she wants to look like, what colours she likes, and then be left in our reception area while the dresser then goes and picks an edit of clothes for her. And then when the client comes into the dressing room, it's very much led by her, so that we find something that she feels great in. And that's the moment. That's the moment when she might look in the mirror and just drop her shoulders and make eye contact with herself and think, yes, I've got this. I think I can do it. And that's always a very wonderful moment for us. So that's what the service hopes to achieve. And I think if anything, SmartWorks is this, as I said, this collection of women helping other women to thrive in that area. And when she's got her clothes, which are all hers to keep, she then goes and has one-to-one interview coaching. And again, that's all volunteers who give up their time and they bring their skill set to us. So they may be executive coaches, they may be people who've worked and done senior recruitment and who can impart some of their kind of experience to a client and help her prepare for that interview. That's a very kind of safe, secure space for that woman to talk and ask questions and get ready for the moment that's coming. So she leaves kind of ready inside and out to take on the interview. And one of the wonderful things about the SmartWorks service is that we're able to show our success. So 65% of the clients we see go on to get the job within a month of their appointment. And that's a really wonderful thing. So that we know that we're making a difference, that actually when a woman comes to see us, there is a very good chance that when she will go on, leave SmartWorks and get the job. And we've been on a bit of a mission over the last 6 or 7 years. I joined when SmartWorks was 1 year old, to really take this service and bring it to life in other cities around the world, around the UK, not the world. We're not that ambitious yet. But we started in London and we've now got 8 centres across the UK and we've supported 17,000 women in that time. And this is a model that works brilliantly in urban areas in particular, where there are the women who need the jobs for the women to go to, and then the volunteer infrastructure to call upon to help with donating their time, donating their clothes, and then donating their funds. And those are the three bits of the service, really. And that's the other reason it's such a wonderful charity. All the clothes in our dressing room are donated. Some of them come direct from retailers. Some of them come from individuals clearing out their wardrobe. Often we might have clothing drives at corporates where they collect on our behalf. And then everything is very carefully sorted and steamed by our wardrobe team, led by an amazing head of wardrobe who ensures that everything that goes onto our rails in our dressing room is top quality, interview appropriate, and that you'd be happy to wear to an interview. So there's a really thoughtful process that goes on behind the scenes to make sure that we get the clothes that we need to dress the women and make them feel not just that it's something that someone has thrown away, but this is a really beautiful piece that will help them and give them the self-belief that they need to shine at their interview. That sense of community has been something that's been so important to us to try and replicate during lockdown. So you can imagine that so much of the SmartWorks service is built on somebody coming into our centres and feeling safe and dressed and then looked after. When COVID-19 hit in March, we were faced with the unthinkable, really, that we couldn't welcome women into our centre, which was really hard. We have the virtue and joy of being a very nimble charity. We're still small enough that we can move quickly and change how we operate. And a lot was driven by necessity. We had a very full calendar in March. We had a lot of young people coming to us who had summers secondments and interviews for those, which had been really life-changing at a very crucial time in their life. So we just thought we have to do something. We have to find a way to get our service to people. And there's our director of operations in the middle photo here, Rosie, with our boxes. You can see one of the parcels on the right. So it's not the same, but it's good enough. It's good enough. So we now speak to our clients when they call us. They're all referred to us from the job centre still or from a charity that's supporting a woman back into employment. We will talk to them about the interview. Then some of our amazing volunteers who can get into our centre will then pick an edit that goes into their box. They might try and Zoom call or a phone call the client and just check on colours and styles and what they might want. And then they get a beautiful box put together with a handwritten note and some bits of jewellery where we can find it, or just those accessories that make you feel great. And that's all boxed off and sent out every day. And then, of course, on top of that, on the left is one of our volunteer coaches. It's much easier to do the coaching virtually, as you can imagine. So we have a virtual service and it worked and it was amazing. It was amazing to be there in April and May when so many people and so many of the charity sector couldn't support people. We found a way to be able to do it. And I was so proud of the team for doing that. And then, as I said earlier, from June, we started working, welcoming our clients back into our centre carefully and with all due respect for the guidelines and regulations that needed to be in place so they could do that safely. And we've been able to do that. And then yesterday we had to again take the heartbreaking decision to stop having clients into our centres as the new four-week lockdown came in. So we're back to the boxes and we're back to our virtual service delivery. But again, we have a full list and full bookings over the next few weeks. And as you can imagine, never has our service been more needed. It's a tough time for people. It's a tough time for everybody. And it's if you are out of work or if you're living in not an ideal accommodation, or if you're a single mum and you're desperately trying to support your families, it's harder than ever. And we're anticipating this is just only going to get harder over the coming weeks and months. So our message to everybody actually is that we are here and we will do everything we can to support people. And one of the things we noticed over lockdown was that actually even securing an interview is so tough in the current economic climate. So we've introduced a new coaching service, which is for women who haven't yet got an interview, but need that extra bit of support and a kind of toolkit to help them secure an interview. So our career coaching service launched in June as a pilot, and actually it's really taken off, and we're delivering that in all our centres across the UK now. So it's amazing to know that in Leeds, in Edinburgh, in Manchester, in Birmingham, in Newcastle, there are women being coached for a job interview, and that also when they get that interview, they can come and see us and we can send them the clothes and we can give them the coaching so that they can get the job. It's a really wonderful thing. And actually, our patron, we announced a new royal patron 2 years ago, the Duchess of Sussex, who got to know us privately. She came to see us in one of our centres just as a volunteer to help with the dressing and coaching. She was a very unnatural with our clients, immediately connected. Was very humble and grounded. And it was a very special time for us. She got to know us and then we announced her as her patron. Her as our patron. And one of the things that she said is that charity really isn't just about giving something that you don't really care about. It's about investing something you care about and that means something to you and passing that on to help another woman at a moment when it can really make a difference to her. So I am going to attempt to play another film, just a short one this time. And this is the Duchess talking at an event we had last September, which feels literally a million years ago. But she came up with a rather brilliant idea of retailers matching a purchase to fill up our wardrobe with the clothes that we need, so that if you, for example, we are also desperate for good bags, it's really hard to find them. And John Lewis agreed that they would sell the perfect bag for an interview, big enough to get your CV or your resume in there. And for everyone bought, one would be donated to SmartWorks, so that a woman buying that piece, that item, knows that another woman who she's never met, but who needs her help, will get this beautiful bag and know that not only she's got that bag, but that in buying it, a woman is really invested in her. And we were able to roll this out with John Lewis doing a lovely bag, Marks and Spencer doing a dress, Jigsaw doing a fantastic trouser suit, and Misha Nunu doing a gorgeous, the kind of perfect white shirt. And I'll just share with you what that looked like.
When I first moved to the UK, it was incredibly important to me personally to be able to connect with people on the ground doing really important work. And one of the places that I went to very early on was SmartWorks. What can I do in some small way? How can I try to help you amplify this? We had a lot of donations, but not necessarily the things that women needed to have. And a big piece of this is trying to transform the idea of charity to community. You don't go through your closet and just toss in a box whatever you don't care about anymore. That's charity as we know it today. Community is going through your closet and saying, this is the blazer that I wore when I nailed my first job interview and got my dream job. And I don't need that anymore because I'm where I want to be. But if I'm able to share that blazer and be part of another woman's success story, then that's community.
I'm getting so good at this. I said that too soon. It's lovely to see those that film and to hear those words and just think it's important to us, the SmartWorks, that we can act as a community, that we can harness the goodwill that I do and believe and see that is out there to help people, especially during these times, and to put it to such good use in a really tangible way that can change someone's life. So I just wanted to leave with a couple of thoughts about how you can support SmartWorks. This list is a little bit shorter than it usually is, just because in the current situation, one of the most obvious ways to help us is to donate clothes. At the moment, we're not able to take donations directly just because of restrictions on movement, but we certainly hope to be restarting that soon. And clothing donations are the lifeblood of what we do. It's incredibly important, not that we have any clothes, but that we have great clothes in a range of sizes to help a woman, and accessories, so shoes and bags, so that we can give a woman a choice and she can find what is right for her. I think that's what really is important to us, that we're not just bossing someone into clothes. We are actually allowing her to just decide what it is that she wants to wear and how she wants to look. And I think that's something that's so powerful. I think everybody knows that feeling when you're wearing the right clothes, you look in the mirror and you know you can do it. And that is a very magical feeling. And that's what we want for our clients. So absolutely, we love donations of clothes. Of course, you can donate funds to us. So we're a charity. We don't have any government funding. We don't have any legacy funding. So we exist by bringing in our own money. So we run various sales and events throughout the year. We have cornerstone funding from foundations. And then we have some corporate funding that comes in for us, which kind of links to the shop for SmartWorks, because we have some very wonderful supporters in Bobby Brown, for example, part of the Estee Lauder group, who sell a product for us every year called the Pretty Powerful product. Sorry, I just noticed lots of chat things and I got distracted for a moment. I would be 1 second and then we're going straight into Q&A's. And there are lots of other products that are often sold, which where the funds and proceeds come to SmartWorks, and that's a really important thing for us. You can also volunteer, and again, that's not up there either, but volunteering at SmartWorks is the best volunteering in the business. You get to see a woman and then you get to find out what happens to her. I've heard lots of our volunteers say to me that we really complete the circle with the volunteering, because it's not just giving your time to an end and you don't see the change. You know, you might be dressing a woman or coaching a woman and then you find out a week later that woman you saw, she got the job. And that's a wonderful feeling to know that you've had a real somebody. And again, we just had to pause recruitment of volunteers at the moment, just because it's harder to get people into our centres and the training and onboarding can be very difficult. But that is absolutely something that we are always on the lookout for, is passionate and committed women who can help our clients in a very tangible way. And that is the end of my presentation. So I'm going to stop sharing, and then I'm hoping that Jenna can make Mary reappear, and then we can hear from some of you.
Let's see. There we go. Boy, isn't this a miracle? I'm always, everyone at KCWC knows I'm stunned when anything technological works for me. And I have several people waiting, my little elves who wait online to help me. They just, I text murmur and they know immediately to come to the rescue. So may I say, I thought that film was unbelievably moving, and your success rate is really something to be, of which you should be very proud. I think it's remarkable that many women get a job after having the coaching service, let alone the dressing service. And it must be so demoralizing to feel that you are just sending these emails out into the ether and that you don't know what is going to help your application be distinguished, that you even get to the chance to have an interview. So by the time these women reach it, I imagine they do feel quite demoralized.
Absolutely, absolutely. And I really believe that a moment can make a big difference to your life. Yes. So the women do come in to see us and they're often looking at the floor. And it seems a very simple thing, but just to take that woman up and look after and put her in control. I think so often people are passed from pillar to post when they're in the benefit system, or they're lost, you know, slightly lost in terms of where they might want to be in terms of running their own life. So just to put them in control and say, you know, what do you want to wear? What do you want to look like? It's a very kind of important part of the process.
And now, how do people find you? Is there anyone else in this space, this market space, that is competing with you, or are people referred to you by job centers? How do they come to know they should go to SmartWorks?
Yeah, we have about 100 referral partners, we call them, around London and in each of the cities where we have a SmartWorks centre. And they're often the job centres or people like the Prince's Trust or other charities that are supporting women back into the workplace. So they have to be referred to us because we're a charity. So it's, you know, that's our check that there's a need, if you like, for our service. So we work very closely with our referral partners. And it, like I say, it's a massive variety. So it could be the prison, people leaving care, or people who might be homeless or in domestic violence refuges. So some kind of people who really need a lot of extra support and care, or it could be people from the job centre who just need that extra boost to be able to get them back into work. So it's a big variety.
And is anyone then ever referred to you, if a candidate is successful, does she ever come back and coach herself or suggest people to you?
Yeah.
So that it's, the circle is completed, as you say.
Exactly. So we often have a lot of word of mouth referrals. So someone will go and say, oh, this is an amazing thing. Because actually it would be very easy to misunderstand the SmartWorks service. You know, if someone was to say to you, imagine you're talking to somebody and it might be a bit of a grumpy man at the job centre and he says, would you like some free clothes from a charity? People are proud and they might well say, no, actually, I don't need that. And they don't really understand what the service is. So we do rely a lot on kind of word of mouth, where people will say, oh, you must go and see them, get your job centre person to refer you or whatever it might be, which is really, really powerful. We don't have too many clients who come back and volunteer just because, and it's something we're looking at, but our volunteering is done during the day. And often people, and if you're just going back to work, you're just going back to work. So it's, in a way, being able to volunteer is doing this kind of volunteering. It's quite a skilled volunteering role and you need to have the time available to do it. So it's tough. It's tough for them often to then give back in that way.
Before I hand it over to everybody else who has questions, I wondered, is there one particular candidate that you personally remember who moved you or inspired you in the years that you've been doing this?
Yeah, no, it's a really good point, actually. I think we've had, there've been a couple of candidates who've really stood out over the summer because it's been such a hard time for people. And we had a woman who came to see us who'd, a lot of people working in the travel industry obviously lost their jobs. And it just really resonated because this was someone her and her husband had both worked for the travel company their whole lives. They'd never faced unemployment. They never thought they would be that person.
Yeah.
And she was then in that situation and just was completely lost. And it was so relatable that you think, because it is one of those things where you think it will never happen to me. It's something other. And actually it is happening to people who a hair's breadth from where you are there, but for the grace of God. And it just really resonated with me. And just that feeling of, you know, she was very honest about it. She said, I nearly didn't come. I nearly didn't take the coaching or the dressing because I didn't feel that I should be asking for that support. You know, it never occurred that I would be in that position, but I did. I was brave and I came, and it was amazing. And she's got a new job, and she's kind of, we helped build her up, and she has got a different role now, and she's starting somewhere else, and it's, she's got herself back, and she just came back alive. And that was really amazing.
Fantastic. So now I'm reading from Teresa Clausen, who is the current vice president and the former president of KCWC, and actually the woman to whom we should be grateful for reaching out to you. She was with whom you were working, writes, it sounds like you give dignity back to women who have been so disparaged by their own personal situation. How do we help with donations to your organization, and what do you need the most?
Yeah, I mean, in terms of clothing donations.
Yes, I would think so.
Yes, exactly. So it's the things that are often the hardest for us to get a good selection of are those things that women might hold on to the most. So lovely bags or shoes, you know, and often the shoes we need are not the kind of crazy party shoes that you bought and never quite wore. They're the kind of sensible courts or the, you know, flat shoes. A lot of women want flat shoes for their interviews. They don't feel comfortable going in high heels. So those are always a big need for us. And then just any smart workwear is always appropriate. We actually do really, I'm not, this is something you can affect, but plus size clothing is always an issue for us. So we get a lot of generous donations from retailers, very beautiful, you know, high-end retailers like Ralph Lauren and Burberry donate to us. But often we get their sample sizes. So we have lots in the kind of 8 and 10 sizes, but the bigger sizes are harder for us to find. So those are particularly sought after for us.
I was going to say at the end of the meeting, but while we're on this topic about donations, is that we are hoping that we can have a live meeting in May at the Royal Geographical Society. And I have asked the women who organize those meetings to make available to SmartWorks a table in our member benefits section where we would advertise ahead of time that someone from your organization will be there, and that perhaps our members could then bring some of these clothing donations, and we can help you in a way that is just what we would have liked to have done. And the reason we postponed this to November, hoping that we could have such a table. But Lisa Woodcock, who I know is very interested in your group, wanted to know where you're based in London, because she's very keen to volunteer.
No, of course. So our North London HQ is in Islington in N1. And then we have a West London Centre in the St. Charles Centre, which is an old converted hospital that you might be aware of in just north of Ladbroke Grove. I think it's W10 or W11 perhaps, where we have our the same setup, so a big dressing room, our coaching rooms, and that's where we run the kind of West London service from.
And another one is asking, does SmartWorks do anything for your clients around hair and makeup to complete the transformation for an interview and a new job?
It's a really good question. So the lovely people at Bobby Brown, we have a makeup artist that comes in once a month to help the women who are there and just gives tips. And we run kind of online, we've been doing online seminars a bit like this with some of the makeup artists and our clients. So once our clients have got the job, actually, I didn't mention, we do run something called the SmartWorks Network. So women can stay in touch with each other and just keep focused when you've just gone back to work, when it could be quite tough. So we run sessions there. The logistics of doing hair and makeup within the core service have always just slightly eluded us, because the people who come to us tend to have quite chaotic lives. Sometimes it's quite difficult to get them to come to this appointment. And then to try and fit in hair and makeup at the same time is too hard as a bespoke thing. But what our stylists will do is just give them advice. And it's done in quite a delicate way, but might just advise about how to wear their hair, ask if they've got any questions about it. And often it might be done in the coaching room in terms of the makeup, if there's, because you don't want to, you're building somebody up in the dressing room. So it's a very delicate process. But it might be that in the coaching room, if there's something pronounced about how they're, you know, if they've got kind of piercings or if they're wearing a lot of makeup that might just not be the right vibe, then that can be picked up in the coaching session. So we do try to do it, but we don't offer it as a bespoke service, if you see what I mean.
Of course, this is yet another example of how a man's situation in a job interview is totally different, because that question would never be asked of a man. Exactly. You know, they can arrive looking completely disheveled and they'll probably get the job. But anyway, spoken as a feminist, I say that. Now, what impact, if any, this is a very good question. What impact, if any, has the change to a more casual workplace in terms of what women wear to work had on SmartWorks, and also therefore what you need for your clients? Are women still, you know, looking? I mean, in my era, which, you know, was 1-800-FOSSIL, they would, you know, you had the business suit and you had to go with the bow on and the crisp looking, and, you know, I take it now there's much more leeway and you don't necessarily have to arrive looking very prim and proper. You could be a bit more casual.
Exactly. And it really depends what job you're going for as well. Yes. So you don't want to kind of overdress. So a lot of the women, a lot of the ladies we're helping might be going for, say, a caring role or a kind of teaching role, that kind of thing. And to work into that in a full suit would not be appropriate. There's definitely been a shift. We're seeing a lot more dresses. So people tend to wear dresses. We do still find that clients want sometimes they do want the armor of a jacket,
a good
fit jacket, exactly. And trousers, and often, actually we had it with the pieces that we had through the Smart Set collection with the Duchess. I used to wear suits and now I don't. I just wear dresses. But there was a black trouser suit in there and people were trying it on and we were photographing people and we were all going, oh my God, it looks amazing. It's so long since I've seen someone in a black jacket, white shirt, trousers. It just looks fantastic. So actually it did make us all want to go out and buy that again. And we do find that it's a very safe thing for a woman to wear if she's going for an interview, is often people want to wear black, although you'll find it's a lovely process during the dressing where they'll come out of themselves and actually say, you know, actually I do quite like a bit of colour, or maybe I could try that scarf, or I haven't worn a dress for 5 years, maybe I am allowed to wear a dress. And that's part of the process, I think. So there's definitely, I think women's relations to their clothes are so, that's part of why the service has the impact it does, I think, is because we're so, it just says so much about how you're feeling about yourself, what you choose, and just kind of giving
it's so linked to our identity. But then again, when you're interviewing for a job, you're often caught in that position of feeling as though you need to change your identity to morph into what it is that the job needs. So the outfit you're putting on and the accessories and everything are so geared to the impression you want to make. Exactly. Now, Orla asks, do your volunteers need to have a certain academic background to help you out?
No, we don't. We don't need an academic background, but we do ask that people have the right skills to be able to bring to the party, if you see what I mean. So huge variety of backgrounds from our volunteers, but actually, qualifications aside, what is most important and most intangible in a way is just being able to connect with our clients and having the right empathy. I kind of referred to it when I was talking, that balance between encouraging somebody and empathizing with them without patronizing.
Yes.
Is a really delicate balance to succeed at. And, you know, often our volunteers might be from completely different walks of life to our clients as well. So you just need to carry yourself lightly and to have confidence to be able to connect with a woman from a completely different situation, but who is incredibly interesting and inspired and wants to learn from you. So,
and I imagine you also have women who are returning to the workplace who have had children or have had a hiatus in their career, and they must have a certain insecurity as well. I mean, it isn't always the young first job. It can also be, I think, much more daunting if you've been out of the workplace and you've had a family and you've, I mean, I was saying to someone who was leaving KCWC that for women, this idea of who we are is so varied that I always say that if you waken someone in the middle of the night when they're at their least prepared and they're most spontaneous, and you ask a woman, are you a mother? Are you a daughter? Are you a sister? Are you a wife? Which role do you identify with first? We aren't sure how we would answer, and it depends on the stage in life you're at. And this, I think, also impacts how we interview. So are you finding that you're getting clients who are, you know, middle-aged women who are trying to come back to the workforce and who are very overwhelmed?
Definitely, absolutely. And often Exactly as you say, really, those women's identities will have been invested in their families, in whatever format that might take. So yes, it's often the most rewarding, actually, because you can see they've done the most amazing things, but might not associate those things with a thing that would help you get a job, if you see what I mean. So yes, they've been busy, you know, running their family and taking care and responsibilities on and looking after all the school stuff, and then thinking, oh yeah, but that, I'm no good at organizing. And you're like, you are amazing. You've done all this. And encouraging someone to be able to say that about themselves is just giving them a moment to reflect and think, exactly as you say. And that can be the most rewarding. I think the thing we've most missed during lockdown is, because when a client gets the job, she can come back to see us for a second dressing. So we give her a kind of enough clothing to get her through to her first paycheck, so she's not just wearing her, you know, the blazer that she got or whatever. And that's such a celebratory moment. She will come back. Often people bring cards or flowers. We have a beautiful thank you board notice in the office. And there's a real feeling of, I did it, I could do it. And that's a very special moment. And it infects the office environment too, because you might have a woman start in reception who's got an interview coming up thinking, oh, I'm never going to do it. Why am I here? And then someone else will come in going, oh, I was here last week and now I've got the job. It's amazing. And it gives it a real sense of buoyancy.
And now I have to ask too, is there a charity doing this for men, or do men simply not need really, in fairness, a man can be equally demoralized, may need interview skills, or is this something that women have to do because we're so overlooked?
Yeah, it's a really brilliant point. There is a London charity called Suited and Booted, which offers the same service for men. And we work very closely with them to give them our kind of processes and procedures, if you like, so they could. And it's a very similar service. We've never done it just because we do women, and it's been our mission to take the service to help women across the UK. And I think it's a different, I think it's needed for men, but it's a slightly different dynamic. It's almost like a reverse reflection in the mirror. We'd need a whole new dressing room. We'd need different stock. We probably need different volunteers. So at some point we may do it, but it would be a bit like a female clothing brand starting to do male clothing. You know, of course there's a need for it, but that's not their specialty.
And naturally, SmartWorks candidates do far better than Suited and Booted, right? The women are outstripping the men, I imagine.
Yeah.
in every category of success at gaining the job. If they're just given the fair shot, they probably succeed. Now, let me just see. I think there's one other. Do you have a follow-up over time to see if the woman is still working?
So that's a really good point. So we judge our success on whether a woman has got a job within a month of coming to see us. So that's where the 65% success rate comes from. And we do then have our network where women can keep in touch with us, but we don't keep a formal tab on whether they've got the job or not. I think there's only so much that we have really toyed with this, actually, but there's only so much that we can claim credit for. And I think what we're saying is that our intervention is very focused and will help get you that job and get you back into the workplace. And that's what we do at SmartWorks. And once you're in the workplace, then hopefully you can progress your career.
Yes.
But we focus on that moment of getting them the job. So I don't know what happens to all our clients, but I do know that we get people into work and that often they do stay in touch with us and become part of the SmartWorks community, really.
And we've had a couple of people say that they would like to volunteer. One lady has actually given me this very impressive CV I'm reading here. But
wow.
How can we organize that, Kate? Can we have some feedback from you that I could send out after the meeting to our members on eBlast or an email that they can send? And even, let's be graphic, a donation platform where if someone doesn't have clothing but wants to now make a financial donation, how can we go about letting them know that?
Amazing. I will send you a few links. So everything kind of exists on our website, but there's a Donate Now page on our website. There's also a lovely section on volunteering where it tells you a little bit more about how it works and how to take forward an application to come and be a volunteer. We do ask that people just kind of take it seriously and fill in a form, and it's really important to us that it's the right commitment for you as well and that people are going to enjoy it, which is why you know we normally get people to shadow and make sure they like it and it's what they want to spend their time on, because people's time is really precious and it's so important that when you volunteer for something that it is what you want to do.
Is it a huge time commitment for the average volunteer?
Well, it depends. coaching people tend to do a day a month, so not that huge. And dressing would be a day every 2 weeks or a day a month. We can flex it according to what time you have available. But we take it quite seriously, and we want it, we are a volunteer led charity, so to join the volunteer team is a commitment for everybody. And
that I would completely empathize with that, because as I'm sitting here asking for people to volunteer, I'm thinking, why are you being such an idiot and asking people who could be volunteering for KCWC to volunteer for SmartWorks? Because believe me, I understand the difficulty of motivating people to volunteer. But I think what you do is so much more important than what we do. That, you know, if we lose someone to you, it's probably a fair exchange. So just so that we know, and in the American spirit of marketing, what is the actual website so that we can, it's www.smartworks.org.uk. .uk. Okay. So we will definitely make sure, .org.uk. We'll make sure that we have a little slide that we can make up and direct people. And is, you said it's shoes and handbags. And so
yes,
our
and
feather
actually,
bow, I take sorry, it the feather boa that I have, you don't
yes.
want, right?
That's, well, that's actually, that's what I was going to say. It was just, we do our best to do, we have some amazing sales essentially. So when things are donated to us, we often get party wear that isn't interview appropriate. So we do take kind of high quality clothing that is not interview appropriate. So if you're clearing out your wardrobe and you have beautiful pieces or that thing you never wore, then please do send it our way. And we have big one-off sales where we bring in quite a lot of our income actually. So, you know, we take all high quality clothing.
That's good. Because I would think that our members must have many things they would like to donate, as well as time. And as you say, the sense that you're contributing almost on the first step of someone's future success is such a gratifying thing. So I'm looking, are there any other questions? I think I've gone through most of these. How do you hear clients? How do clients hear about the charity? We went through that. How can we donate over the next month? Are you taking clothes in? Not in person, but you are by post, right?
Yes, people can post in, and then we'll start the drop-off service again as soon as we're out of lockdown.
And Wendy asks, do you have any relationships with potential employers who may have job vacancies available in these difficult days? That's a good question.
It's a really good question, yeah. And we don't, historically we haven't, but we have started looking at it very recently, actually. We're just about to... we've just found an internship for Estee Lauder. So they created an internship they're recruiting it from our client network. So actually it's quite a nice marriage where people have internships and opportunities. We have a good client base of people who want interesting jobs. So I think it's something we'll look at more in the future.
And of course, another organization that's very female centric and, you know, has all the charitable arms for breast cancer and, you know, the Estee Lauder organization is amazing in terms of promoting women in every way. What do they call it? I think the gentle touch, how you can, there's a philosophy within Estee Lauder, how you can reach out gently, but still make an impact. And that it isn't just about makeup, it's about beauty from within and the pink ribbon movement. And, you know, they're an amazing, amazing organization. Sue Wimpenny, just wanted to say well done for helping all these women. Fantastic charity, actually constructively helping women. Thank you. And Sue Wimpenny should know because she ran a construction company with a pink helmet for
I
women.
I love that.
The lady builder, yes. She did, so she definitely knows what it's like to be in a female organization. So before I say goodbye, I'm going to ask you to just be patient for a minute, Kate, and listen to a few of the KCWC announcements. And of course, you're welcome to join us for any of these, especially our Zoom lectures. But just for the housekeeping, Art History has moved the lecture they had on November 11th to Zoom. And if you're interested, naturally I'm losing my voice now. If you're interested, that is Details are on the website. British History and Contemporary Art had to sadly cancel their walks and gallery visits, but we hope they are only postponed. And then our next news is our next general meeting, which will be on a Friday, December 4th, where we will welcome speaker again by Zoom webinar, Francesca Cartier-Bruckel, who will be Zooming from her great-grandfather's home in France, Jacques Cartier's home, where, as one does, she was in the basement searching for a bottle of champagne. And what does she do? She opens a trunk and finds the motherlode of Cartier designs, history of gems, the list of their clients, and so began an odyssey where that she wrote a book about the untold story of the jewelry empire and the family. It is a fabulous lecture where she will show you a gem and then show you the design from her grandfather's bookshelf of the jewel. It's remarkable. And I guess if they could possibly donate something to SmartWorks, who knows, wouldn't that be great? And we are hoping too that you will use the link on the KCWC website under posts and purchase in advance Francesca's book from Daunt Books so that we can help support our speaker program here. And so all that remains is for me to wish everybody who's watching among our membership and for SmartWorks, I guess a not too stressful lockdown period. We all are discovering more than anything the importance of social contacts. And I think women have a remarkable inclination and talent to be able to intuitively connect. And we really are working hard at KCWC, and I'm sure you are at SmartWorks, to help and support women through this difficult time where we need to gab, we need to be together. And I hope we can continue to do that, because women, when they work together, are an unbeatable force. And it has been very inspiring today to hear the work you're doing to help women get back into the workplace and as a result, feel better about themselves. So I will applaud you and all our members. And I will thank Jenna for being so patient and answering my frantic technology emails. And we'll look forward to getting that information, Kate, about how we can help. And again, thank you so much for your patience and your gracious hospitality today in hosting the webinar.
Thank you so much. It's been an absolute pleasure.
I'm glad. Thank you. Bye, everybody.
Bye-bye.